the law cannot treat a child in the same way that it treats an adolescent. So a recognition that protection has to be balanced against evolving capacity.
Hello, and thanks for joining us for another episode of Prostasia Foundation's podcast series, Sex, Human Rights, and CSA Prevention. This month, we're talking to Lucy Minayo. Lucy is a lawyer and works as the Capacity Building Manager for Africa at the Center for Reproductive Rights. She's also the author of a recent report called Criminalizing Adolescence, A Call to Reform the Sexual Offences Act. So I'm going to be talking to her about that report and her work in Kenya. Thank you very much for joining us today.
It's a pleasure.
Now, you're the author of a report by the Center for Reproductive Rights and the Federation of Women Lawyers called Criminalizing Adolescence, A Call to Reform the Sexual Offences Act. So can you tell us a little bit about how Kenya's Sexual Offences Act treats adolescents who have, as you've described it, non-coercive and non-exploitative sex with each other?
Yes, thank you, Jeremy. So what the law does is it does not recognize adolescents as having the capacity to make decisions about sexuality. So it essentially does not recognize them as having the capacity to consent to sex and sexual conduct. So when they do engage in sex, when the law is applied, they are arrested and imprisoned in most of the instances that we have investigated. So that is how it happens with adolescents that are engaged in non-coercive, non-exploitative sexual conduct.
So how does this criminalization of their conduct also create a barrier for them accessing reproductive health services?
Okay, so two things happen with criminalization. The first is that criminalization creates confusion in the minds of adolescents themselves as to the legality of their engagement. So what the criminal law does is it drives them their practice, the practice of their sexuality underground. So adolescents would not want to expose themselves to the threat of being reported and action being taken against them. So they will go underground and continue doing their stuff underground. And that means that they will not seek, they will not go to a health service provider to seek a service because the likelihood of them being reported is quite high, or the fear of being reported is quite high in their minds. Now, the second thing that criminalization does and which creates a barrier is that it communicates some confusion in the minds of service providers as to whether in providing services to adolescents, they are actually promoting the commission of an offense that is outlined in the Sexual Offences Act. So what this does is to make service providers a bit hesitant to provide services to adolescents, or they will just not provide services to adolescents. Criminalization also, in the minds of service providers, what it does is it influences provider stigma, and it influences their attitudes. And so if an adolescent presents before a service provider that views them judgmentally or, you know, has some attitudes about why they're engaging in sex and sexual conduct, they will, you know, it will keep adolescents away. Then they will not present themselves before the facility or this particular service provider who has this biased attitude towards adolescents.
Let's give an example of the effects of the Sexual Offences Act in practice. So I was very interested in reading your report to read about the story of a young man who is referred to as DOB in the paper. Can you please tell our listeners a little about his story?
Okay, so DOB is a young man that we encountered in our investigation, in our research. He comes from the western part, a community in the western part of the country. And he was from three students. I don't know the equivalent in the American system could be, but he was not in primary school. He was in secondary school, so just about to get out of secondary school and join the university or college. And he was engaged in, he was in a relationship with a girl. And so the story is that at some point, so this girl was sent by the grandmother to get something from the shop, to purchase something from the shop. And when she went back home late, so when she went to the shop, allegedly, and met up with DOB. And then when she went back home, the grandmother made some noise. Why are you coming back home at this late hour in the night? So the girl tells the grandmother that, oh, I was actually raped. And the idea was, you know, to, if these are things that normally happen, you know, you try to blame another person so that, you know, the penalty that is meted out or the punishment that is meted out on you is not as strong. Unfortunately, so this spiraled out of control. DOB was arrested by the police and charged in court for defilement and found guilty. And he's currently spending 20 years. He's serving a 20-year term in prison. There are a lot of complications with this case because when the matter went before the court, DOB was actually tried as an adult, but at the time of commission of the alleged offense, he was a minor. And so these are some of the problems that we are seeing with the implementation of the law. And DOB is not the type, is not, DOB should not be behind bars. He was involved in a consensual relationship with his girlfriend. The grandmother to the girlfriend was unhappy about that relationship, and that's what led to him being arrested and him being spending time in prison.
Is that quite a common scenario that a family member will report an adolescent to the police for having consensual sex with a girlfriend or boyfriend?
It is common because in the course of our research, we came across many such cases. And so we just were unable to access prisons to document the cases of the stories of those young men. But we spoke to girls, their girlfriends, their so-called wife, but their girlfriends, you know, who even had children. And this is something that happens. And what the thing is, when the girl gets pregnant, that's when this thing becomes a problem. But the relationship will actually be condoned. The parents of the girl and the parents of the boy will know about the relationship. But it's pregnancy, or if the girl elopes, you know, those are the things that drive families to report consensual sexual conduct to the police. Mm.
So one of the other things that you note in your report is that under the Convention on the Rights of the Child, there's an acknowledgement that the capacities of the child are evolving, and as their capacities evolve, as they grow, their sexual agency grows along with it, so that it's something of an incremental stage of development. But the age of consent is not like that. The age of consent is, you might say, binary. It's either under or over. How do we deal with the fact that these are, in a way, in conflict, the evolving capacities versus just a single age of consent? How can we deal with this discrepancy?
Okay, so one thing is that what's happening in Kenya is telling us that age of consent is just that. It's just an age. It has no impact on the decision-making capacity of an adolescent. So it's problematic. Now, the recommendation that we make is that so the law, yes, was set up to address predatory sexual conduct. Mm. It was set up to address sexual violence. And that distinction must be made in the law. And how you make that distinction is, one, by criminalizing consensual sexual conduct between, you know, among adolescents. So those that are below 18 and are engaging in sexual conduct with each other, adolescents below 18, you decriminalize that conduct. Then secondly, you address the question of adolescents having sexual engagements with young adults. So this could be people who just turned 18 or people who are not as old, slightly older than the adolescent. So you introduce an exception in law that recognizes that this conduct is also not, it's not violent, and you exempt this, the adolescent and this young adult from the threat of criminal penalty. So that's how you address the question of evolving capacities. It's in recognizing that the law cannot treat a child in the same way that it treats an adolescent. So a recognition that protection has to be balanced against evolving capacity. And what we have currently is a protectionist approach to sexual conduct, and adolescents that have the capacity to make decisions and are making rational decisions to engage in sex with each other are caught up in this confusion, in this lack of clarity in the law.
I was quite surprised to learn that the word defilement is used to describe sex between adolescents. I don't think that this word is really used in the United States or in some other countries, because it seems to innately reflect a stigma against adolescent sexuality. Do you agree?
No, so sex with minors is broadly referred to as defilement in Kenya. So whether it's an adult having sexual intercourse with a minor or minors amongst themselves.
Yes.
And so I think it communicates something about how we view minors and what we think about. So defilement, I mean, if you even look at how the term defilement in its literal sense, it's it communicates some type of depurification of, you know, of a pure product.
Yes.
And so it really is communicating how we define us and what we think about people that have sexual interactions with minors.
So what are some of the effects of this sexual stigma on adolescents? You've already described one of these, which is that they're less likely to access reproductive health services. Are there any other negative effects of this sexual stigma?
Yes. So one is that adolescents' sexual stigma has actually impacted on provision of information to adolescents. And I think that the thinking has always been that if you provide information on sex, sexuality, reproduction, reproductive health to adolescents, that the default setting will be that they will have sex. And that, you know, they will incessantly have sex. But the idea behind sexuality education is not that. It's the adolescent needs to be empowered to understand themselves, to understand their body, and to make decisions, informed decisions. So yes, stigma has had an impact on provision of information to adolescents. Secondly, it has implications on the development of healthy relationships among adolescents. So we see there's an increase, reportedly, an increase in, you know, sexual conduct that may not necessarily be appropriate or may not necessarily be healthy. And that's just because these people are not able to access, adolescents are not able to access information, are not able to access, they cannot talk about their sexuality with anybody. And that has implications on healthy sexual relationships in that cohort.
So you referred a little bit to sex education. I'm not that familiar with sex education in Kenya. Can you tell us a little bit about how comprehensive is it? Does it cover topics such as consent and pleasure, or is it really just about anatomy and sexually transmitted diseases?
So we do not have comprehensive sexuality education offered in our schools at the moment. We have a curriculum on comprehensive sexuality education that speaks about sex, sexuality, that you know, things to do with gender identity. It also talks about menstruation, things associated with sex, sexuality, and reproduction and reproductive health. But that policy has not been implemented because we have, the Ministry of Education has experienced a lot of pushback from religious groups and other conservative groups that are opposed to the provision of this information to adolescents. So what adolescents are currently, the information they are currently receiving in schools is limited to menstruation, it's limited to anatomy, and it's limited to life skills. So they call the curriculum life skills, but life skills that is separate and distinct from comprehensive sexuality education.
Mm. So you mentioned that there are religious influences on what can be taught in schools. How powerful is the are those influences, and does that also is that also part of the reason why the Sexual Offences Act treats adolescent sexuality in the way that it does?
Yes. So we have seen over the years a growth in the influence of conservative religious groups in policy making, particularly with regard to sexual and reproductive health rights in this country. So religious groups are quite powerful. They have a pulpit every Sunday or every Friday, depending on the religion or whatever day it is. They have wide reach and they have significant influence over how we conduct our affairs as a country, how we conduct our affairs as a society, and even how we conduct ourselves in our families. Now, I would not say that, I would not attribute the resistance to, or the you know, the way the law is structured, I would not attribute it wholly to the influence of religious institutions or religious groups. So they have not exclusively impacted on how the law is drafted or how the law looks like. I think we just have a problem, a societal problem. And the societal problem that we are facing is that we view adolescents as asexual.
Mm.
We don't see them as having reproductive health needs. We don't see them as needing to exercise, as even having reproductive health rights. And that has implications. That is what has informed the law. So we view them as beings that need to be protected, protected from all forms of violation, and we view, including non-coercive, non-exploitative sexual conduct, as inherently violent, as a violation of adolescence.
Mm.
So this protectionist approach is problematic, and it's problematic because we are seeing a rise in teen pregnancies, we are seeing a rise in HIV infections among adolescents. We are seeing an increase in school dropouts because if adolescents get pregnant and decide to out of this non-coercive, non-exploitative sexual conduct, they will likely drop out of school and be driven into child marriage. So it's a bigger societal and not exclusively attributed to religious institutions. They do a role, there's a role they are playing. Their continued resistance to preventive efforts is problematic, but they're not wholly to blame for where we are at the moment as a society. Yeah.
So one of the things that was most interesting about your report was that you identified some problems in terms of international human rights law with the criminalization of adolescents for non-coercive and non-exploitative sexual conduct. Can you identify some of the legal problems, also not just under international law, but also under Kenyan law? Can you identify some of those problems or describe some of those problems that you found?
Whereas we have a law on children that specifies the way a child in conflict with the law should be treated, and this law on children is very categorical that a child in conflict with the law should really face imprisonment as a very last resort in compliance with international human rights law, the reality is that the Children's Act is not being applied in cases in sexual offences, in many sexual offences that we reviewed. So minors are tried under the Sexual Offences Act, and the problem is when they are found guilty, many of them are actually sentenced under the Sexual Offences Act, which means the mandatory minimum sentences are applied on minors. Whereas in the Children's Act, there's a raft of recommendations in there, you know, optional sentences, particularly if you're a first offender, etc. And some of them include counseling, include probation, and many others. So that's not being done. So that is highly, that's a big problem in terms of just access to justice and juvenile justice for that matter. The second legal challenges, I mentioned it earlier, it's just this failure to distinguish violent sexual conduct from non-coercive, non-exploitative sexual conduct. In our view, non-coercive, non-exploitative sexual conduct is not conduct that should find itself, that should be addressed in the criminal justice system. We need to address adolescent sexuality, but in other ways,
yes,
not through criminal.
So you've made some recommendations for how the not only how the Sexual Offences Act could be amended, but also how the implementation in various agencies and parts of government could be improved. How are other countries dealing with this problem? Because, of course, this is not a unique issue for Kenya. What are some of the ways that other countries have addressed this?
Okay, so we have a couple of examples. So in South Africa, they actually adopted the Romeo and Juliet clauses in their laws. So the distinction in South Africa is that their age of consent is 16, but what the law recognizes is that minors that are, so anybody that's below 16 that engages in sexual conduct with each other, they don't view that, that is non-coercive and non-exploitative, they don't view that as a sexual offense. And that does not interact with the criminal justice system.
Mm-hmm.
Where minors in sex with persons that are slightly older, that are, you know, that are adults in line with the law, but slightly the age difference is not more than, I think, 2 to 3 years, then those interactions are also excluded from criminal penalty. So those are also not considered an offense. Where it's established that it was non-coercive, non-exploitative. Rwanda recently, as well, decriminalized consensual sexual conduct among adolescents, and so we are because the law was just amended last year. We are hoping to see some changes, or we'll be monitoring that situation with our partners to see the implications of that on minors. On adolescent sexual and reproductive health rights. Botswana, we recently learned that Botswana just amended its law to exempt adolescents from who are engaging in non-coercive, non-exploitative sexual conduct with each other from criminal penalty. So these are just a few examples on the continent. And importantly, in South Africa, for instance, the law was actually very, very problematic because in addition to criminalizing adolescent sexuality, it also imposed an obligation on providers to notify, to report these cases when they were brought to their attention, which was highly problematic. So that was also amended in the law. So those are a few examples of how on the continent countries are dealing with the question of adolescent sexuality. I'll just say that it's a big problem. These are things, because we engage with stakeholders in countries like Tanzania, Uganda, Malawi, Zambia, these are questions that have arisen, that judicial officers are grappling with because of ambiguity in the law. And so a lot of the continent are beginning to contemplate revision of their laws to address the question of adolescent sexuality.
Well, this has been very interesting. Unfortunately, we're out of time, but if our listeners would like to learn more, I'm going to provide them with a link to the report itself. But is there anything else that you would recommend listeners could read or anyone they should follow on the internet to learn more about this topic?
The University of Pretoria, there's a publication that we put out to the University of Pretoria, the Center for Human Rights. It's called Legal Ground. It's accessible on our website, reproductiverights.org, or the website of the Center for Human Rights, University of Pretoria. So there's a lot of information in there, documentation of cases on this issue that would be interesting for your listeners to read up on and just, get up to speed with what is happening and why we are calling for a reform of laws that criminalize adolescents.
Very good. Well, I'll make sure that there's a link to that as well in our podcast. So thank you very much indeed for taking the time to explain the work you've done, and very good luck to you in obtaining the necessary reforms in Kenya.
Thank you very much, Jeremy. It was a pleasure to speak to you and to your listeners.
And thank you for watching this episode. We'll be back next month, so to make sure you don't miss it, please subscribe to our podcast, or if you're watching on YouTube, click the button that you see here to subscribe to our channel. Please also consider donating to our cause. Thank you very much again, and we'll see you next month.